And thank you for coming to our second of three series of events this evening. This is now the award ceremony where we give the St. Oscar Romero Award to the honorees this evening. And to start us off, I'd like to express my appreciation to Father Satish for coming here to UD and for sharing with us a prayer and his reflections on the life and legacy of St. Oscar Romero.
First of all, my most sincere gratitude to all of you for the invitation. I have to begin with a caveat. I'm very humbled for one, but I'm not approaching this as a scholar who understands Romero in, I don't assume or pretend to understand Romero in any deep way, especially I feel humbled in the presence of those who are receiving the award. I'm not a Romero expert. I'm not a Romero historian. I haven't written dissertations on him. I haven't even been to El Salvador. But he was martyred in 1980, and I joined the seminary as a 17-year-old in 1983. So I grew up under the shadows of his martyrdom, and there was not a day in the seminary in India where Romero was not celebrated. So I've grown reflecting and studying about him, but he is truly my personal hero. This reflection is very pastoral, very pastoral. I'm staying away from academic thoughts on Romero. I want to end with a prayer, so let me go on with the reflection. Oscar Arnulfo Romero y Galdamez was born 15th August 1917 in Ciudad Barrios in El Salvador. He was ordained in Rome in 1942 after he graduated and received a licentiate in theology in 1941. Romero was appointed auxiliary bishop for the Archdiocese of San Salvador in 1970, and in 1974, the bishop of the Diocese of Santiago de Maria, a poor rural region. He became the Archbishop of San Salvador on 23rd February 1977, and it was in this capacity that he would be drawn into the complexities, controversies, and exigencies of San Salvadoran social and ecclesiastical life. While his appointment was welcomed by the government, many priests who saw liberation theology as the necessary pastoral tool to the oppressive political system were disappointed. They feared that his conservative reputation would be detrimental to the progress liberation theology had made in the lives of the poor masses. The turning point in Archbishop Romero's life was the brutal murder of the Jesuit priest, Father Rutilio Grande. Along with him, two lay people, Manuel Soloranzo and a 16-year-old boy by the name of Nelson Lemus. On hearing the news, Romero rushed to the murder scene. Perhaps no other event would have a more life-changing effect on his life than seeing Father Rutilio Grande and his companions bullet-ridden and lifeless bodies. He later said, "When I looked at Rutilio lying there dead, I thought, if they have killed him for doing what he did, then I too have to walk the same path." That evening, Archbishop Romero presided over a mass at 10:30 p.m. where all the three bodies were laid in state in front of the altar in the church in El Paisnal. The next Sunday, Archbishop Romero decided to have a single memorial mass at the cathedral in San Salvador. No masses were celebrated that weekend in all of El Salvador. 150 priests and more than 100,000 people were present. This was the first mass movement of people that would ultimately lead to a holy revolution led by whom I call a reluctant revolutionary martyr, Archbishop Oscar Arnulfo Romero. In 1979, the coming of power of the revolutionary government junta, its human rights abuses, and an escalation of violence would ultimately end up developing as the Salvadoran Civil War. In February 1980, Romero pleaded with the United States and the then President Jimmy Carter to cease US military aid to the regime. Carter ignored Romero's pleas, and military aid to the Salvadoran government continued. The rest is history. On March 23rd, 1980, Romero delivered a sermon that would also seal his death sentence. He preached, "I would like to make a special appeal to the men of the army and specifically to the ranks of the National Guard, the police, and the military. Brothers, you come from our own people. You are killing your own brother peasants when any human order to kill must be subordinate to the law of God, which says, thou shalt not kill." He went on, "In the name of God, in the name of the suffering people whose cries rise to heaven more loudly each day, I implore you, I beg you, I order you, in the name of God, stop the repression." On March 24th, 1980, Romero had just spent the day in recollection organized by Opus Dei, and in the evening celebrated Mass at the Divine Providence Chapel. A red automobile came to a stop on the street in front of the chapel. The gunman emerged from the vehicle, stepped to the door of the chapel, and fired one, possibly two shots, and then sped off. Romero was struck in the heart and collapsed at the altar. Romero was dead, but a martyr was born. Saint Oscar Romero did not merely leave behind a history of heroic Christian life. He left behind a legacy for modern-day martyrdom. May I expound this legacy from three vantage points? First, reconciling contradictions. Romero was strongly influenced by the charism of Opus Dei, an institution that one normally associates with orthodoxy and rigor. The larger vision of Opus Dei focuses on the holiness of life. Very early in his priestly life, as early as February 4th, 1943, Romero's diary entry read thus: "In recent days, the Lord has inspired me a great desire for holiness. I have been thinking of how far a soul can ascend if it lets itself be possessed entirely by God." Opus Dei and liberation theology are not approaches to Christian life that are easily reconciled in the minds of theologians and pastors like me, or for that matter, the Congregation for the Doctrine of Faith. His beatification and ultimate canonization were debated and disputed for many years. The question raised was whether his assassination was motivated solely by hatred for the faith, or was it influenced by politics, liberation theology, or by his courageous yet calculated critique of the social realities of this country. Romero would have been pained by these disputes. Romero would be pained at the ideological divide that torments contemporary Catholic Church today. His preaching and teaching make it clear that he did not see the contradictions in the seemingly opposing approaches. A journalist once asked him, "Do you agree with liberation theology?" Romero answered, "Yes, of course. However, there are two theologies of liberation." The liberation theology Romero did not approve of was the one that reduced the struggle for justice to a purely temporal project, to a material well-being, or only to initiatives of a political or social, economic, or cultural order. He was also concerned about the danger of the kind of liberation theology that could succumb to the temptation to resort to violence. He categorically rejected the use of violence, whether it was incited by the junta or by its victims. Rather, as he would say, the most profound social revolution is the serious, supernatural, interior reform of a Christian. On the day he was gunned down, he had spent the entire day at a recollection organized by Opus Dei. I interpret Romero's quest for social justice and his opposition to totalitarianism as his quest for personal holiness, a holiness that expressed itself in a shepherd laying down his life for his people, a personal holiness that by virtue of its character leads to a striving for just and egalitarian society. Friends, true holiness cannot be contained with the constraints of one's soul. True holiness acts in self-sacrificing love for the poor and oppressed. Romero bears witness to the truth that the Christian calling is one, a personal call to holiness that has radical implications for the common good. Secondly, allowing social realities to appeal to the holiness within. Whereas many people were unhappy with Romero's appointment as Archbishop of El Salvador because of his non-committal social stance in the beginning, as time went on, he stood at the forefront of the struggle for human rights. While his involvement in the social struggles made his initial critics happy, it displeased those members of the archdiocesan clergy and staff who supported the junta. In spite of it all, Romero stood on the right side of history. The large-scale disappearance of people and the murder of Father Grande became compelling reasons for Romero to plunge headlong into the social struggles. Whereas in my first point, I have argued that Romero was compelled by the demands of holiness to respond to the social realities, the compelling social realities of oppression could not have been ignored by any person with a conscience. Romero remained firm in his resolve to respond to the atrocities in the way social realities demanded. He did not hide behind institutional exigencies or ecclesiastical propriety. Rather, he risked it all, even his own life, for the sake of the gospel and the needs of the poor. Similarly, there are social realities today that tug at our hearts and souls. The systemic economic inequalities that create social instabilities in neighboring nations, policies that uproot agrarian families, that give rise to crime, drugs, and violent extortion, that creates refugees and asylum seekers, that villainizes and victimizes asylum seekers, that separates, are compelling reasons in our times today. These are compelling reasons for us to respond as radically as Romero did. Ecclesiastical institutions, institutions of higher education, clergy, people like me are often tempted to maintain a decorum that befits our dignity and sometimes our security, well-being, and our future. Romero calls out to us. Nothing should be at stake when human life and dignity are violated. When history judges us 20 or 30 years from now, which side of history will we be found standing? My hope and prayer is that we will be on the same side that Romero was. And finally, a martyr like Romero aims for imitation of Christ. The movie Romero, which is a realistic and accurate biography of his life, depicts numerous moments of Romero's life where there are striking similarities between Romero's martyrdom and that of Jesus. One time, feeling lost and despondent, he fell on his knees in the same way that Jesus did in the Garden of Gethsemane, seeking God's light and direction. In fact, this is a great insight into the understanding of martyrdom. The greatest motivation for the early Christian martyrs was the imitation of Christ. They willingly accepted martyrdom because through it they most closely imitated Christ. The martyrdom of the first Christian martyr, Stephen, is set in terms of the imitation of Christ. Stephen preached the gospel boldly like Jesus did. As he was being stoned to death, Stephen uttered words similar to Jesus on the cross. Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. As he died, imitating Christ, he forgave his enemies. Time does not allow me to go into the details, but the martyrdom of Saint Polycarp also has striking similarity to the martyrdom of Christ. It is in light of this reflection on the martyrdom of martyrdom as an imitation of Christ that I suggest that Romero is a true martyr. He was a good shepherd like Jesus. He did not run away when he saw the wolf coming. He cared for his flock in danger. Finally, he gave up his life for his sheep. As John says, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The church for many years held the title martyr from Romero because she could not determine whether he was killed because of hatred for the faith. Perhaps she was asking the wrong questions. It is now clear that in his life and death, Romero imitated Christ. To that extent, Romero is a martyr. Today, on the occasion of the awarding of the Romero Award, Romero appeals to our collective conscience. His life and death compel us to bridge the ideological divides that exist in the church today. His martyrdom compels us to respond radically to the social injustices of our time and to respond to them as a response to God's call to holiness. Romero invites us to the imitation of Christ, an invitation to love as Christ loved us and to the end. So I would like us to all join in this prayer, and I'm presuming the lights can come on and we can all pray the prayer together. You may have received the prayer. It's not your traditional prayer, but these words are attributed to Saint Romero. So can we just pray this together? It helps now and then to step back and take a long view. The kingdom is not only beyond our efforts, it is even beyond our vision. We accomplish in our lifetime only a tiny fraction of the magnificent enterprise that is God's work. Nothing we do is complete, which is a way of saying that the kingdom always lies beyond us. No statement says all that could be said. No prayer fully expresses our faith. No confession brings perfection. No pastoral visit brings wholeness. No program accomplishes the church's mission. No set of goals and objectives includes everything. This is what we are about. We plant the seeds that one day will grow. We water seeds already planted, knowing that they hold future promise. We lay foundations that will need further development. We provide yeast that produces far beyond our capabilities. We cannot do everything, and there is a sense of liberation in realizing that. This enables us to do something and to do it very well. It may be incomplete, but it's a beginning, a step along the way, an opportunity for the Lord's grace to enter and to do the rest. We may never see the end results, but that is the difference between the master builder and the worker. We are workers, not master builders, ministers, not messiahs. We are prophets of a future, not our own. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The massacre of El Mozote and the surrounding area, one of the largest and most violent massacres in Latin America's recent history, has yet to be brought to justice in the 37 long years since it happened. Here is a short summary of the struggle for justice in this case. Despite the testimony of Rufina Maya, the sole survivor of the massacre, who watched as her neighbors and relatives were cruelly murdered, forensic evidence and documentation by international journalists, the Salvadoran government continued to deny the massacre took place. In 1990, the victims filed a criminal complaint against the state, but it was labeled communist propaganda and ignored.
No dejo de pedir justicia porque fue tan cruel, tan duro lo que hicieron en el Mozote y lo voy a dejarle daño.
In 1993, the approval of the amnesty law froze the case, impeding it from being tried. Finally, in 2012, the state officially recognized the facts of the case and apologized to the victims.
Por esa masacre y por las aberrantes violaciones de los derechos humanos, en nombre del Estado salvadoreño, pido perdón a las familias de las víctimas.
Despite the state's apology, when the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights declared the massacre a crime against humanity and ordered that its investigation be reopened, the Salvadoran judicial system ignored the order, maintaining impunity for the crime. It limited its investigation to exhuming the remains and returning them to the communities. All this despite the fact that in 2014, Ernesto Rivas Gayón, the Salvadoran ambassador to the U.S. during the war, apologized for denying the existence of the massacre and admitted that he was following direct orders from the Salvadoran government. This signaled the involvement of the highest levels of government. In July 2016, the amnesty law was declared unconstitutional, allowing war crimes to finally go to court. In September 30th of that same year, just 2 months later, Judge Jorge Guzman Urquilla reopened the investigation at the petition of the victims' lawyers. For the first time in Salvadoran history, 18 former high-ranking officials of the armed forces were formally accused of crimes against humanity. Among the accused were General Flores Lima, the former chief of staff of the armed forces, Juan Rafael Bustillo, ex-commander of the Salvadoran Air Force, and the first military officer to use the Truth Commission's report in his defense because his name was not personally listed in it. And the highest-ranking officer, former Defense Minister José Guillermo García, who was deported back to El Salvador from the U.S. in 2015 for the human rights abuses that were part of his military policies during the war. The roles of other military officers, such as the late Colonel Domingo Monterrosa and Major Armando Asmitia, among others, are also being investigated in honor of truth and justice for the victims. The first hearing in the case took place in March 2017, and since then, more than 39 witnesses have testified against these military officers. The Argentine forensic anthropology team that performed the first exhumation of the area in 1990 was also called forth to testify. They declared that all of the evidence definitively supports the guilt of the defendants.
Toda la información que hemos recuperado hasta este momento avala y reafirma los dichos de los sobrevivientes y de los familiares y de los testigos.
La evidencia física creo que es aplastante en este caso. Y aunque no hubiera habido sobrevivientes y testigos, sinceramente encontrar 136 niños en un cuarto de 4x7 con más de 267 fragmentos de proyectil y cartuchos de proyectil allí, sinceramente nunca me tocó una exhumación de tanta cantidad de niños. O sea, sí me ha tocado exhumar niños, pero no en esa cantidad.
Although the defense continues to question every detail of the victim's testimony and delay the trial, the more serious issue is that the state continues to deny the existence of military documents registering the operation, documents that likely name the officers who helped plan and coordinate it. In December 2017, the Salvadoran government complied with the sentence from 5 years prior and released official statistics on the case. 1,725 total victims, survivors, and people affected, 988 people killed, of whom 551, or the majority, were minors. Even more shocking, 86% of the children killed were under the age of 12, and 44% were under the age of 6, too young to even handle a rifle. Furthermore, 12 unborn children were killed. The massacre of El Mozote is not only an offense against all Salvadorans, but also humanity, especially children. A sentence in the El Mozote case would reaffirm that children are not the targets of military campaigns. A sentence in this case is a step towards transitional justice and would honor the memory of innocent victims. A sentence would allow us to break the cycle of impunity in this country. Currently, time is not on the victim's side, and the possibility of seeking justice decreases each time the trial is delayed. We cannot allow this case to remain in impunity. This is an opportunity for El Salvador to set a precedent in Latin America and the world and champion human rights.
So I wanted to introduce the film, but it went on, and as you can see, it's around the El Mazote case, the one that is being investigated and prosecuted by our honorees tonight. But to give the award and provide us with some brief reflections of his own, I am very grateful to the president of the University of Dayton, Eric Spina, for being him and welcome him to the floor.
What a powerful and haunting film that illustrates a lot of important things, but importantly, the power of telling your story over and over in the face of injustice. It speaks to the ongoing struggle for truth and justice, the need to champion human rights for the voiceless in our world. It speaks to the efforts of our honorees today in seeking justice and accountability for killings and violence in El Salvador. Before I present the 2019 Oscar Romero Human Rights Awards, I'd like to thank the Executive Director of the UD Human Rights Center, Shelley Inglis, for her vision and tireless work in organizing the symposium with her staff and shedding light through the lens of Catholic social teaching on the importance of accountability for state violence in Central America, past and present. The rights and experiences of migrants, refugees, and asylum seekers coming over the border, and the vital role and impact of grassroots human rights advocates and humanitarian service providers. This is deeply worthwhile, demanding, and complex work, more important today than ever before. And everyone in this room who is engaged in this struggle deserves our thanks. I also want to offer a special thank you to Ann Hudock for moderating the panel previously, and very grateful for the insights of our distinguished panelists who serve on the front lines for human rights and advance the dignity of all people. And thank you, Father Joseph, for your reflections on the ministry of Saint Oscar Romero. May I now ask the three honorees to come to the stage. First, just a few words about the significance of this award. Oscar Romero, the Archbishop of San Salvador, spoke up courageously for the poor and the marginalized before he was silenced by bullets while he presided over Mass nearly 40 years ago. A martyr, he was canonized as a saint by Pope Francis just last fall. In 2000, 19 years ago, the University of Dayton established the Romero Human Rights Award, an international award that honors an individuals or organization whose work in the spirit of Saint Oscar Romero has contributed significantly to the alleviation of human suffering and injustice. The award itself, a bronze statue of Saint Romero, is an original piece sculpted by University of Dayton graduate Emily Trick and Marianist brother Gary Marcinowski. And as you can see for yourself, it is a stunning piece. Today, the University of Dayton very proudly bestows the 2019 Oscar Romero Human Rights Award on these three brave, principled lawyers from two different leading human rights organizations in El Salvador. We applaud them as a university and as individuals for their persistence and dedication in uncovering war crimes and their ongoing work in prosecuting those responsible for one of the largest state-sponsored massacres in Latin America, one that, as we just saw, murdered nearly 1,000 people, more than half of whom were children. Through this award, we pay tribute to David Morales from Cristosal and Ovidio Mauricio Gonzalez and Wilfredo Medrano from Tutela Legal for seeking justice and accountability. Your voices matter. Your work matters. Your spirit of perseverance reminds us that the struggle for justice continues. On behalf of the University of Dayton, congratulations and thank you. You honor us with your presence.
Muchas gracias, señor presidente Espina, la doctora Shelly Inglis del Centro de Derechos Humanos, la doctora Miranda Hallett y todas las personas de la universidad, autoridades, estudiantes, profesores de la Universidad de Dayton que nos dan este reconocimiento. Quiero expresarles mi agradecimiento también a las comunidades de fe y organizaciones que apoyan y han instaurado junto a la Universidad de Dayton este premio, Monseñor Romero. Monseñor Romero es ahora una figura universal, es ahora un santo de la Iglesia Católica, San Óscar Romero de las Américas, y es un orgullo para El Salvador que él haya pasado por nuestro país. Otro mártir salvadoreño, el rector de la Universidad Centroamericana, asesinado en 1989, dijo que como señor Romero Dios pasó por El Salvador. Y realmente ese legado de Romero es importante para transformar el mundo y las injusticias del mundo al día de hoy. Observamos en el video a una de las sobrevivientes más icónicas, la señora Rufina Amaya, una humilde campesina del departamento de Morazán en El Salvador, donde esta masacre ocurrió. Junto a ella asesinaron no solo a sus cuatro hijos y toda su familia, sino exterminaron su comunidad entera. Y por 25 años Rufina Amaya denunció este crimen. La masacre fue negada por el gobierno de El Salvador, fue negada por la embajada de los Estados Unidos en El Salvador. Fue negada por el gobierno de los Estados Unidos de aquel momento bajo la administración del presidente Ronald Reagan, por los altos mandos de las Fuerzas Armadas de El Salvador. Cuando en 1992 abrimos la fosa 1 del caserío El Mozote, cuyas fotos observamos, y se recuperaron los esqueletos de 136 niños cuyo promedio de edad era de 6 años, fuimos testigos de cómo la verdad de esta humilde mujer campesina y de muchos sobrevivientes del Mozote era más poderosa que todo el poder del dinero y de las armas que había construido una mentira y dicho que la masacre era una leyenda. Y son estas víctimas sobrevivientes de las comunidades las que emprendieron desde entonces un largo camino de 30 años en lucha por la verdad, la justicia y la reparación. El Mozote no fue un caso único, tristemente. Fue un patrón de violencia, una cadena de masacres que durante 4 años se instauró en El Salvador y que ocurrió también en Guatemala como una estrategia de contrainsurgencia. Durante 23 años el caso estuvo ilegalmente archivado con fines de impunidad, de proteger a los responsables, hasta que en 2016 fue reabierto. Recibimos con mucho honor este premio, pero también con mucha humildad. Somos tan pequeños ante una figura tan gigantesca como la de Monseñor Romero. Pero son realmente estas víctimas sobrevivientes del Mozote y de muchas otras masacres en El Salvador y Guatemala, quienes ahora demandan justicia, verdad y reparación, las que están transformando la realidad de nuestros países. Y su voz debemos hacerla nuestra, y es nuestra obligación acompañarla. Esperamos contribuir con nuestro esfuerzo posible que aún pequeño permite a estas víctimas seguir luchando por la justicia y alienta a las víctimas del presente que sufriendo otro tipo de violencias y otro tipo de violaciones también ven sus casos en impunidad y están abandonadas. Quiero reconocer el trabajo de mis compañeros del equipo de tutela legal. Originalmente trabajamos juntos en el Arzobispado de El Salvador y emprendimos este camino en 1990. Y quiero agradecer a mi equipo de trabajo en Cristosal, en el que estamos luchando por obtener justicia para estas víctimas, acompañándolas. Gracias de nuevo a la Universidad de Dayton por este reconocimiento que recibimos en nombre de las víctimas, que recibimos en nombre de las personas que son las depositarias de este legado humanista de Monseñor Romero. Muchas gracias.
Muy buenas noches. En primer lugar, quiero agradecer el habernos otorgado el Premio Derechos Humanos San Óscar Romero. Creo que este galardón, en nombre de las víctimas, estamos obligados a recibirlo porque son miles y miles de víctimas a quienes representamos en El Salvador. Quiero destacar en primer lugar, que Monseñor Romero es el símbolo de la impunidad en El Salvador. No basta con tenerlo en los altares, sino también saber la verdad jurídica. Sabemos por la voz popular quiénes fueron los autores intelectuales y materiales, pero queremos saber jurídicamente quiénes fueron para sancionarlos, al igual que los responsables de la masacre del Mozote. Hoy por hoy, de manera inédita, están sentados en el banquillo de los acusados 17 altos jefes militares, quienes en la época del conflicto armado tenían el poder de decidir a quién asesinar, a quién desaparecer, a quién privar de libertad y a quién privarlo de libertad y desaparecerlo. De esta manera, está como organizaciones de derechos humanos, tutela legal.
Salvador, que él haya pasado por nuestro país. Otro mártir salvadoreño, el rector de la Universidad Centroamericana, asesinado en 1989, dijo que como señor Romero, Dios pasó por El Salvador. Y realmente ese legado de Romero es importante para transformar el mundo y las injusticias del mundo al día de hoy. Observamos en el video a una de las sobrevivientes más icónicas, la señora Rufina Amaya, una humilde campesina del departamento de Morazán en El Salvador, donde esta masacre ocurrió. Junto a ella asesinaron no solo a sus cuatro hijos y toda su familia, sino exterminaron su comunidad entera. Y por 25 años Rufina Amaya denunció este crimen. La masacre fue negada por el gobierno de El Salvador. Fue negada por la Embajada de los Estados Unidos en El Salvador. Fue negada por el gobierno de los Estados Unidos de aquel momento bajo la administración del presidente Ronald Reagan, por los altos mandos de las Fuerzas Armadas de El Salvador. Cuando en 1992 abrimos la Fosa 1 del caserío El Mozote, cuyas fotos observamos, y se recuperaron los esqueletos de 136 niños, cuyo promedio de edad era de 6 años, fuimos testigos de cómo la verdad de esta humilde mujer campesina y de muchos sobrevivientes del Mozote era más poderosa que todo el poder del dinero y de las armas que había construido una mentira y dicho que la masacre era una leyenda. Y son estas víctimas sobrevivientes de las comunidades las que emprendieron desde entonces un largo camino de 30 años en lucha por la verdad, la justicia y la reparación. El Mozote no fue un caso único, tristemente. Fue un patrón de violencia, una cadena de masacres que durante 4 años se instauró en El Salvador y que ocurrió también en Guatemala como una estrategia de contrainsurgencia. Durante 23 años el caso estuvo ilegalmente archivado con fines de impunidad, de proteger a los responsables, hasta que en 2016 fue reabierto. Recibimos con mucho honor este premio, pero también con mucha humildad. Somos tan pequeños ante una figura tan gigantesca como la de Monseñor Romero. Pero son realmente estas víctimas sobrevivientes del Mozote y de muchas otras masacres en El Salvador y Guatemala, quienes ahora demandan justicia, verdad y reparación, las que están transformando la realidad de nuestros países. Y su voz debemos hacerla nuestra, y es nuestra obligación acompañarla. Esperamos contribuir con nuestro esfuerzo posible, que aún pequeño, permite a estas víctimas seguir luchando por la justicia y alienta a las víctimas del presente que sufriendo otro tipo de violencias y otro tipo de violaciones también ven sus casos en impunidad y están abandonadas. Quiero reconocer el trabajo de mis compañeros del equipo de tutela legal. Originalmente trabajamos juntos en el Arzobispado de El Salvador y emprendimos este camino en 1990. Y quiero agradecer a mi equipo de trabajo en Cristosal, en el que estamos luchando por obtener justicia para estas víctimas, acompañándolas. Gracias de nuevo a la Universidad de Dayton por este reconocimiento que recibimos en nombre de las víctimas, que recibimos en nombre de las personas que son las depositarias de este legado humanista de Monseñor Romero. Muchas gracias.
Muy buenas noches. En primer lugar, quiero agradecer el habernos otorgado el Premio Derechos Humanos San Óscar Romero. Creo que este galardón, en nombre de las víctimas, estamos obligados a recibirlo porque son miles y miles de víctimas a quienes representamos en El Salvador. Quiero destacar, en primer lugar, que Monseñor Romero es el símbolo de la impunidad en El Salvador. No basta con tenerlo en los altares, sino también saber la verdad jurídica. Sabemos por la voz popular quiénes fueron los autores intelectuales y materiales, pero queremos saber jurídicamente quiénes fueron para sancionarlos, al igual que los responsables de la masacre del Mozote. Hoy por hoy, de manera inédita, están sentados en el banquillo de los acusados 17 altos jefes militares quienes en la época del conflicto armado tenían el poder de decidir a quién asesinar, a quién desaparecer, a quién privar de libertad y a quién privarlo de libertad y desaparecerlo. De esta manera, está como organizaciones de derechos humanos, tutela legal y el equipo de Cristosal está tratando de romper el estado de impunidad que existe en el país, El Salvador. No hemos roto totalmente la impunidad, pero estamos dando pasos concretos que van encaminados hacia ello. Digo esto porque el caso del Mozote es el caso mejor documentado que existe ahora en El Salvador, que tiene la prueba científica, documental, testimonial, en donde no es posible refutar esa prueba. Por todos los medios legales o ilegales que quieran hacer los defensores de los militares, vemos que es imposible que no lleguemos a un veredicto condenatorio, y precisamente es interesante condenar a estos militares porque no solo están involucrados en el caso del Mozote. Ya decía David, son responsables de múltiples masacres que han causado dolor, lágrimas en muchos padres, muchos hijos, muchas madres que aún todavía en El Salvador andan buscando a sus hijos desaparecidos, a sus esposos desaparecidos, que son un número de más de 10.000 salvadoreños que no se sabe en qué lugar se encuentran, en fosas o cementerios clandestinos. Es un reto grande para nosotros recibir el premio San Romero de América, porque es un compromiso más. Tenemos que echar al hombro este compromiso que llevamos desde la Universidad de Dayton y hacerlo público en El Salvador, porque no es un reconocimiento a nosotros, sino al empuje, a la perseverancia que han tenido las víctimas de esperar tantos años hasta lograr la anulación de la ley de amnistía, que precisamente hemos empujado también nosotros. Y ahora pues tenemos este premio, en honor a ellos nos debemos, a nuestra fundadora de tutela legal, María Julia Hernández, quien ya falleció, pero cuyo legado también queremos llevarlo hacia un éxito final, como es luchar contra la impunidad en El Salvador. Muchas gracias.
Perdón, que voy a leer, me pongo muy nervioso más en este acto, pero reitero mis saludos al Pleno. Agradezco a quienes dirigen esta universidad el darnos ese honor de recibir el Premio de Derechos Humanos San Romero. Nuestro guía era San Romero, es nuestro guía en la lucha hacia la dignidad del ser humano y la obtención de una verdadera justicia. Lucha en la que también estuvo, como lo dijo el compañero, nuestra querida María Julia Hernández, fiel defensora y seguidora de Monseñor Romero. Con ella, pues, tenemos ese legado valioso. Fue ella quien grabó las homilías de Monseñor Romero y las transcribió para que la tuviéramos. Hoy podemos conocer el pensamiento de Monseñor Romero a través de esas grabaciones y esa transcripción que hizo María Julia. Ella fue impulsora del proceso más grande de Latinoamérica, de la masacre más grande de Latinoamérica en tiempos nuestros, la masacre que se denomina El Mozote y lugares aledaños, donde fueron asesinadas más de 1.000 víctimas por el ejército salvadoreño, el genocidio más grande de América. El recibir este premio es una alegría, un orgullo, pero también es un compromiso que nos obliga a continuar en la lucha por la justicia, lucha que iniciamos hace más de 30 años junto a los sobrevivientes de este doloroso hecho. Una frase acuñada por las víctimas y que se encuentra en el monumento erigido para la masacre, dice: no queremos venganza, solo queremos justicia. Como vemos, la existencia de una real justicia es la que enaltece a una nación, y eso es lo que buscamos, que también nuestra nación se enaltezca con una buena administración de justicia. Como cristianos, debemos de saber que en Proverbios encontramos una orden. Dios nos dice: hay que levantar la voz y hacer justicia para defender a los pobres y los necesitados. Esto es cumplir el Evangelio, ruta que Monseñor Romero cumplió hasta el extremo. Muchas gracias.
Okay, everyone. Thank you so much for coming. This now is the close of the ceremony, and we go walking out in the lovely evening to the law school, to the atrium, where we will have our reception. We will drink and discuss the issues of the day, and we will launch America the Borderland, the multimedia exhibit, the result of the Moral Courage Project's work in El Paso. And enjoy. So please join us all. I know it's a bit of a walk, but we do have President Spina, Provost Benson, Dean Pierce, Dean Strauss, and others with the honorees and our featured speakers walking there now. So please do join us. And thank you so much for coming and honoring human rights defenders.
Shirts and shoes for 14 hours.